anybody remember these kind of songs? See, I got a few on this side that already picked it up. Play it again. Come on. See what y'all got. Listen. I'm a soldier. I'm a soldier. I'm a soldier. I'm a soldier. Said I'm a soldier. Yeah. I'm a soldier. I'm a soldier. Yeah.
Zion. It is good to be able to gather with you once again on this third Sunday in the month of January. Amen. Amen. It is good, and I want to welcome all of you, all of our Greater Mount Zion family and friends, and any new viewers that we may have. And if we do have any, if you would, just be kind enough and click the heart that's there on the screen in the chat area to let us know that you're here. If you don't want to put your name out there or anything, that's fine. But we would love to, if you would let us know that you're with us this morning, because we do welcome you to be with us in our worship service. And we're very happy that you took the time out to join us. Amen. Amen. Well, beloved, we're here to worship our God and our King. Amen. And so we want to get ready to do that. And so if you don't mind, I want you to get ready to bow your heads with me as we get ready to invoke God's presence wherever we may be. So if you don't mind, please bow your heads. Eternal God, our Father, Lord, we come in the magnificent name of Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and Savior, thanking you, Lord, for another day of worship, thanking you for bringing us through another week, for keeping us and sustaining us. And so, Father, as we get ready to worship you, we pray right now, Lord, that you would allow your presence to be where we are. Make yourself felt, God, so that we may know that you're with us, and that we may give you our best worship and our best praise. And so in the name of Jesus Christ, God, we pray that everything that's said and done in this worship service is done to your pleasing, to your name's glory. In Jesus Christ's name, we pray and we thank you. Amen. Well, beloved, let us get ready to worship God, and let us start out by giving him praise right now. So if you're able to, right where you are, let's give God some praise. Amen. And let's get ready to worship him. I've said going through last year that as we come into the new year and as we plow our way through this pandemic, that we're going to have to come back better than when we left. Amen. Even when we come back into the Lord's house, we're going to have to come back better. And so right now in 2021, we want to be better in what we do for the Lord than we were last year. And what that means is our worship should be better. My preaching should be better. Our teachers' teaching should be better. Our deacon serving should be better. Our ushers should be better. Everybody in the Lord should be better going forward than we were last year and before we entered into this pandemic. Amen. Amen. So let's get ready to praise God and give him what he so rightfully deserves from us. Amen. Well, my brothers and my sisters, it's prayer time now here at Greater Mount Zion. And as we get ready to go to God's throne of grace, we want to continue to remember our sick and our shut-in. Remember those who you know that we may not know who have asked you to pray for them. Amen. Keep in mind families who are part of our church who are still somewhat grieving due to the loss of loved ones. On this past week, we had the homegoing services for Sister Burton, the wife of Deacon Burton. So continue to pray for that family and continue to pray for others who we know that are dealing with health issues and that are journeying down that road of bereavement. Amen. And then also continue to pray for our church, our city, and pray for the United States of America. Amen. We know what is going on and what has taken place. Understand that this weekend and even into Monday, Monday is Dr. Martin Luther King's birthday, the day that we celebrate. Matter of fact, this whole weekend, some have been celebrating that. And I find it kind of odd that we're celebrating it and the rise of racism has risen back to the top. Amen. I was listening to a radio program this week and the gentleman asked a very profound question. He asked if Dr. King, if he was still alive, would he be satisfied with the way things are going on today as it relates to his message and agenda? Many asked the question and said they thought he would be a little bit, but I would say he would not, because even though we've made some progress, we've regressed ourselves as a people in some areas of our lives that we can do better in. Amen. There's some things we've settled for that we should not have to settle for. And then when we look at what's going on in our country, I'm a firm believer in the fact that when you look at the message that he proclaimed, I believe that Dr. King would frown on what he sees going on today. Amen. But pray for our nation. Pray for this world. Pray for yourself. Amen. Amen. So if you don't mind, please bow your heads. Eternal God, our Father, Lord, we come in the name of Jesus Christ, asking you first, Father, to forgive us of our sin and to please have mercy on us. Forgive us, God, because we know we haven't been our best. We have not done all that you've asked us to do. And we've done a lot of things and said a lot of things and even thought a lot of things we shouldn't have. And we need you to forgive us and to have mercy on us. And then, God, as we come to you, we lift up our sick and shut-in to you, praying in the name of Jesus Christ that you will continue to be with them, Father, letting them know that although they may be homebound and may have a health issue, God, that you're still there, comforting them, giving them sufficient grace to deal with what they're going through. We pray right now, God, for those, Lord, who are able to move around, but they're struggling with health issues and pain. We ask you in Jesus Christ's name to deliver them, free them from whatever is trying to restrict them from being their best for you, God. Be that great healer that you are in their life. Then, God, we pray for families who are journeying down that road of bereavement. Their loved one, you've called from this land. They need your strength and comfort, and so we ask you to continue to be with them. We pray, God, for those who are still struggling and dealing with this virus that's in the land. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, God, that in your own sweet time that you would remove it. And we also pray, Father, that you would work through the vaccine, God, so that we may get back to some sense of normalcy in our lives. But Father, until you act and until you go to work, we'll wait on you. Because we know, God, that you're only going to do it in your own sweet time. Then, Father, as we come to you, we lift up our church to you. We give you thanks and praise for all you've been doing here at Greater Mount Zion. Thank you, Father, that you blessed us to stay together and to remain. Thank you for your sustaining power, God. Thank you, Father, for your financial blessings that you've blessed this place with. And then thank you, God, for giving those of us who's in charge of it enough sense to use it, Father, to beautify your house and to do the things that need to be done here. We thank you right now for everyone and every family that makes up our church. And we thank you, God, for blessing us, Lord. And then, Father, we pray for the city of Milwaukee. We ask you in the name of Jesus Christ to end some of the senseless violence that's taking place on our streets. Reach from heaven, God, and touch these mean streets, Father, and bring about some peace in the land. We pray right now, God, for our world and for these United States. God, I don't even have to give you a record of all that's going on because you see all and know all. We just ask you right now in Jesus Christ's name, God, to end this racism that exists in the land. Remove it, God. Get it out of the way, Father, because it hinders us as humanity. It keeps us from being the people that you desire us to be. And our nation will never be blessed, God, until we move past our differences. And understand, God, that we all bleed red and that we are all your creation. And then, God, we pray for our world, ask you to bring peace across the land everywhere. We lift up those who are viewing right now, God, and we lift up their families to you. We pray, God, you continue to be with them and to bless them with what they need. Whatever they've come to you, Father, and asked you for, Father, we just ask you to answer their prayers, to provide them with what they need in the way you see fit, God. And then, Father, we just want to give you thanks right now, because with everything that's going on down here, you've still been good to us. You've still been blessing us, God. You've still been watching over us and taking care of us. And so in the name of Jesus Christ, we just want to give you praise right now. We want to give you thanks. And we want to give you our best hallelujah. Because you deserve it, God. You deserve all the credit for everything that's good and perfect in our lives. In the name of Jesus Christ, God, we lift up your name because we understand that if it had not been for you, we wouldn't even be here today to worship you. And so we thank you so much in Jesus' name. Now, God, we pray that you hear our prayers today. Pray that you will answer them. Pray that you would accept our prayers. In the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ's name, we pray and we thank you. Amen. Well, beloved, we want to get ready to receive our announcements. And then after our announcements, we will be able to worship God through our giving. Amen. Amen. I spoke a little earlier about us being better going forward. And that means even being better in our giving to the Lord. Amen. Amen. So we're going to get ready to pray for the offering that will be received. So if you don't mind, please bow your heads again with me. Father, we thank you for what's about to be received. We thank you for the givers today, God, as we worship you through giving. We pray, God, that you would touch our hearts and minds and help us to be generous to you, giving back to you because you've been so generous to us, Father. And then, Lord, we pray that what is received here at Greater Mount Zion, Lord, will continue to be used to take care of your house and do the work that you called us to do. In Jesus Christ's name, we pray and we thank you. Amen. Well, beloved, during the offering period, you'll have a chance to click the hand that says, I want to give, or you can click the donate button and give that way. Those two areas will take you to Givelify, which is the electronic giving app that we use here at Greater Mount Zion. Also, our address will come up, and you can mail in your gift or your offering to the ministry here at Greater Mount Zion. Amen? Amen. Let us get ready to receive our announcement.
So amazing, you hear. Change.
Amen. Beloved, thank all of you for participating in the offertory period. We thank God for your gifts and offerings that you've given to Him through the Greater Mount Zion Missionary Baptist Church. Well, beloved, it is now time to hear word from the Lord. Amen. Amen. So if you would, please bow your head. Eternal God, our Father, Lord, we thank you for this preaching moment that has arrived. We thank you for your word. Thank you for Holy Spirit. Thank you for providing, God. So right now, we ask that you preach to us. Preach to our hearts and minds. And help us, Lord, to understand your word. Use me, God, as your vessel. Use me, Lord. Use my mind, my heart, and my lips to proclaim your word. Allow me the liberty, God, to proclaim it with power and conviction, that all of us would be helped and that we all would be better. In the mighty name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ's name, we pray and we thank you. Amen. Amen. Beloved, if you have your Bibles, I need you to go with me to the book of Numbers, Numbers chapter 14, and we will read verses 1 through 4. For our new viewers who are with us, there is a Bible tab there that you can click on if you don't have a Bible with you. You can use any version of the Bible you would like. And go with me to Numbers chapter 14. I tend to use the Holman Christian Standard Bible, the HCSB, but you're free to use whatever Bible you choose. And also to our new viewers, there's a notes tab there, and that notes tab just has an outline of today's sermon. Amen. Amen. So go with me. Numbers chapter 14, beginning at verse 1 and ending at verse 4. And this is what you will find there. It says, then the whole community broke into loud cries, and the people wept that night. All the Israelites complained about Moses and Aaron, and the whole community told them, if only we had died in the land of Egypt, or if only we had died in the wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to die by the sword? Our wives and little children will become plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us to go back to Egypt? So they said to one another, let's appoint a leader and go back to Egypt. Amen. My friends, for a little while this morning, I want to share with you from this thought, rejecting what the Lord has for you. Rejecting what the Lord has for you. I want to share this word with you today because I'm a firm, believer in the fact that God always has something good for us. I believe as we move forward from this point on in our lives, that we need to listen to God, listen to what he says that he specifically has for you. And as a church, we need to listen for what God has specifically for us. Amen. We need to listen for it. Then we need to be prepared to go and get it. Amen. But we need to be careful. We need to be careful that we do not get into what we call a spirit of rejection. That we don't allow maybe what we see or maybe what we hear from others cause us to turn back instead of going after what God has for us. We need to make sure that we put some blinders on when it comes to some people and some things that may try to hinder us from going after what God has told us he has for us. Have I got a witness? Now understand, I am not a prosperity preacher. That's not me. But I am a firm believer in the fact that God just has some things for us. And many times we don't get it because of what we see or what we hear. Because we allow what we see and what we hear to cloud our minds and muzzle out what God has told us. Are you with me? And so today I want to talk about this rejecting what the Lord has for you, because you may be thinking to yourself, when I know that God has something for me, I never rejected him. Well, I'm about to prove you wrong in a little bit here. So as we look at rejecting what the Lord has for you, keep this in mind that what God has for you, and we hear this all the time, it is for you. And nobody can keep you from receiving it but you. You need to write that down, because too many times we blame other folks and other people for why we don't get what God has for us. But beloved, if the truth be told, you are the only reason that you have not received what God has for you. Amen. So, as we begin to look at this, understand that the word reject, as it relates to our text, means to dismiss as inadequate, inappropriate, or not to one's taste. What is being given or offered is not up to our standards. Some of us have rejected some people, jobs, and relationships because we felt they didn't measure up. And although it was what the Lord intended for us, we rejected it. Amen. He or she did not look like what we wanted them to look like. And so we bypassed them. We rejected them. And we're still in a long state today. Amen. Still by ourselves today. Because we passed it up. Some folks are still on a job they can't stand because it paid a little more money than the job God actually intended for them. Didn't pay enough money. So I would rather put up with the hell that I'm in than to do the job that the Lord actually had for me. We rejected some things. We passed up some things because they were inadequate or inappropriate or not to our taste. And beloved, even when it comes to the Lord, there are people who reject him because they feel he's inadequate. His death on Calvary's cross for their sin is not enough for them. So they decline the salvation that he has to offer them. And then, beloved, there are those of us who have a relationship with the Lord who reject what he has for us. He's promised it to us. And because we can't see it in the form or shape we would like, we fail to move forward in faith to receive it. We reject what the Lord has for us. We act just like the people in our text. They rejected what the Lord had for them. To begin to understand what is taking place, we have to go back to chapter 13. In chapter 13, the Lord spoke to Moses, told him to send some to scout the land of Canaan that he was going to give them. Now hold on to that because it's very important. But not only did God tell Moses to send them, but he told him who to send, a leader from every tribe. So Moses did as he was told. After the men returned from scouting the land, two of them, Caleb and Joshua, gave a good or favorable report, and 10 gave an unfavorable report. And as a result of the two conflicting reports, the people embraced what I like to call a grasshopper mentality. They believed the report of the 10 and embraced a puny mindset about themselves and the God they served. And as a result of embracing the grasshopper mentality, the people of God refused to move forward. They were rejecting what the Lord had for them. And so as we look at the people in our text, please note there are three things we need to observe that will let us know when we are rejecting what the Lord has for us. First thing is, we are rejecting what the Lord has for us when we begin to listen to negative people. It has been said that negative people have a problem for every solution. Mark Twain said, "Don't walk away from negative people, but run." Amen. As I stated earlier, the people in our text received two different reports from the spies or scouts who went to check things out in the land the Lord said he was going to give them. The people rejected the positive report in verses 26 through 30 of chapter 13 and believed the negative report in verses 31 through 33. Well, how do we know that? Well, look at verse 1 of our text. There it says, "Then the whole community broke into loud cries, and the people wept that night." Look at this. The moment they heard the negative report, they responded by crying and weeping. When the positive report was given, nobody said, "Praise the Lord." But as soon as the negative report was given, they cried, and the text says that the people wept that night. You see, beloved, negative news distorts our thinking. It engages our cognitive biases, trapping us in negativity. You see, when our negative biases are turned on, it's hard to turn them off. And no matter how false a negative story may be, we will find evidence to support it. Let me see if I can make this relevant to you. There's something about us that loves negative news. We love to get a bad report. We seem to respond quicker and longer when we receive bad news. Like the people in our text, as soon as they heard the bad report, right away they started bawling their eyes out. And beloved, they did it all night long. They didn't say anything about the good report. Nobody said, praise God. Nobody said, hallelujah. Nobody said, thank you, Lord. Nobody said, thank you, God. Well, my friends, negative news about what the Lord has for you will come from negative people. According to psychologist Nikki Martinez, negative people say things like it's too good to be true. Negative people dwell on the past. Negative people judge others. Negative people don't accept compliments. Negative people have an automatic thought process that is negative. Negative people have trouble maintaining relationships. Negative people are always focused on the problem and not the solution. Negative people are not excited about the future. And so, beloved, with all that going on with negative people, why would you listen to them when it comes to what the Lord has for you? Because when you listen to negative people, they will try to talk you out of receiving what's yours. When you listen to them, you provide room for doubt to seep in, and you begin to question whether or not the Lord told you what he has for you. When you listen to negative people, you invite the devil to join the conversation, and he will block out of your mind what God has told you. When you listen to negative people, they will kill your joy and have you crying all night long. When you listen to negative people, you will refuse the positive message from the man or woman of God. And beloved, when you listen to negative people, you will end up rejecting what God has for you. So when negative people get in your ear, shut them down right away, navigate through the negativity, and go for what the Lord has promised you. Don't reject what the Lord has for you. It may be a new job. It may be a new home. It may be a new relationship. It may be an education. Whatever it is, my friends, if God has told you it's yours, then why would you listen to some negative report from a negative person? Don't listen to negative people when the Lord has something for you. The second thing the text shares with us as far as it relates to rejecting what God has for you, and that is when we remain where we are or desire to go back. Yes, we are rejecting what God has for us when we remain where we are or desire to go back. In verses 2 and 3 of our text, we see the rejection mountain is growing. Israel's rebellion is reaching its climax. Look at what the text says. It says all the Israelites complained about Moses and Aaron, and the whole community told them, if only we had died in the land of Egypt, or if only we had died in this wilderness. Look at this. Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to die by the sword? Our wives and our little children will become plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us to go back to Egypt? You see, brother, a whole lot of churches get stuck in the past. God is trying to push you forward. He's trying to move them forward. And all they can talk about is Egypt. All they can talk about is what they used to do. And God is trying to push or move them forward into the blessing that he has for them. Well, look at this. The verbs pile up in an attempt to express the passions that have been unleashed. Look at what they do. They reflect or think that anything they have experienced up to now will be better than Canaan. It's a shame when you think what you've been through or what you are in is better than what God has for you. Well, beloved, that was the mindset of the people in our text. Their thought, look at it, moves from Egypt to the wilderness to Canaan and then back to Egypt. The people were so afraid to go after what the Lord had promised them that they contemplated staying where they were or going back to where the Lord had delivered them from. Time had dulled their bitter memories of Egypt, so they continued to reject what the Lord has for them. The text says all the Israelites complained about Moses and Aaron. Well, my brothers and my sisters, I need you to know something today. Anytime you complain against or about the man or woman of God, you are complaining against and about God. Woodrow Kroll, president of Back to the Bible Radio, said, ultimately, all complaints are directed against God. Out of fear from the negative news they received from the 10 negative spies, the people began to complain. They began to sin because they were complaining. And brothers and sisters, understand, complaining is a sin. Look at what they were saying. If only we had died in the land of Egypt, or if only we had died in this wilderness. They desired death over what the Lord had for them. They were so caught up in rejection of what the Lord had for them, watch this, that they preferred a funeral over a fortune. Beloved, have you been there? Have you allowed what you've seen or heard from negative people cause you to desire death over what the Lord has promised you? And when I say death, I'm not talking physical death, but what you heard or seen caused you to feel so low that you didn't even want to exist. You wanted to go somewhere and hide and not be seen. But beloved, listen at this. Verse 3 hits hard because it suggests The Lord wanted to harm them. In verse 3, they said, "Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to die by the sword? Our wives and little children will become plunder. Wouldn't it be better? Wouldn't it be better for us to go back to Egypt?" In these two questions that the people are asking, or that's being asked by the Israelites, we see such insolence or disrespect and base ingratitude toward God. After all the Lord had done for them, why would they question God's care for them? Well, beloved, many of us need to know that God does not want to harm us, and never has or will. God only has the best in mind for us. God had a blessing for his people. They were being handed a land that was flowing with milk and honey. They were being handed a land that was fruitful. They were being given a land where their hands had never worked the soil, a land that was shown to their father Abraham in Genesis 12, 4 through 8, a land that God promised to give them. Yet they questioned whether God wanted to harm them. Instead of going for what the Lord had for them, they were deciding whether to stay in the wilderness or go back to Egypt. They were rejecting what God had for them. Well, my friends, are you choosing between staying where you are and going back? Or are you going for what God has for you? Are you going to reject the blessing that God has promised you? Or are you going to get it? Are you going to remain in the mindset that suggests things will not get better? Or are you going to have a mindset that says, God has made me a promise and I'm moving forward to receive it? What are you going to do, beloved? Are you going to question God's care for you? Are you going to allow what you see and what you hear from negative people move you to reject what God has for you? Or are you going to believe the Lord and go and capture it? Are you going to question whether God loves you and has great intentions for you? Well, before you ask that question, I need you to think about something. Think about all that God has done for you. Think about how you made it where you are. Think about where the Lord met you at and how you were feeling and how you were. Think about how he's been bringing you through a pandemic. Before you question whether God really cares about you, just think about where you are right now. Don't stay where you are. Don't go back to Egypt, but go and get what the Lord has promised you. Finally, beloved, you are rejecting what the Lord has for you when you choose to follow someone else instead of God. Now, I know Moses and Aaron were leading the people of God, but God was their true leader. He led them out of Egypt. He led them through the Red Sea. He led them across the Jordan. He led them by a pillar of cloud by day and fire by night. And as their leader, God fought all their battles, and now he was getting ready to lead them to the land that he promised them. However, Israel decided decided not only to reject what the Lord had for them, but they also rejected God's leadership. These folks went from bad to worse very quickly. He promised them a land, and they should have moved in faith to go and get what he had for them. But look at verse 4 of our text. There it says, so they said to one another, let's appoint a leader. Go back to Egypt. Look at that. Let's appoint a leader and go back to Egypt. Instead of going for what the Lord had promised them, Israel decided. Israel decided, not God, they would return to Egypt. They would much rather be back in slavery than to progress and go for what the Lord had for them. Now, my friends, I can say a whole lot right there, because just as the people of God in our text had a slave mentality, there are some today who are of the same mindset. They have a mental attitude that includes feelings of inferiority and a need to be controlled. They need to know that they are free and that the Lord has something great for them, and they need to go for it. Well, my friends, whenever we decide to follow someone else other than God, we will end up enslaved to them and where they will lead us. Because anytime we don't follow God, I'm here to tell you there is no neutral. You are end up following the devil. And understand, beloved, whoever you decide to follow, which will be the devil, they will never lead us to what God has for us. And my friends, although God has blessed his church with pastors who are considered leaders, the people are to follow him only when he's following God. Amen. Get that in your spirit. You follow him as he follows God. However, when the people see that their earthly leader is leading them away from what God has for them, then it's time to have a conversation. Have I got a witness? Watch this. In chapter 13 and verse 2, God said to Moses, send men to scout out the land of Canaan I am giving to the Israelites. From Abraham to the point in our text, God had been promising to give his people the land of Canaan. And now that they were on the verge of receiving it, they rejected it, and they rejected God, because now they want someone else to lead them and lead them back to where the Lord delivered them from. Let's appoint a leader and go back to Egypt. Oh, beloved, when you choose to follow someone else instead of God, when you choose another leader instead of the one who has been leading and taking care of you all your life, when you decide to choose a leader other than the one who's made a way out of no way for you, when you decide to choose a leader other than the one who's been blessing you and providing for you, whenever you decide to choose a leader or someone else instead of God, then you are rejecting God and what he has for you. And beloved, when you reject God and what he has for you,
I'm here to let you know there is a price to pay, and the price is God will let you have your way. God will allow you to go back into whatever had you enslaved. God will allow whoever you decide to follow lead you back into misery instead of forward into his blessing. As a matter of fact, if your desire is to stay where you are because of some negative news that you heard, God will leave you right where you are. As it relates to the people in our text, watch this, beloved, because they rejected what the Lord had for them, because they rejected God, Moses pleaded on behalf of the people, and God responded in verses 20 through 23 of this chapter. There God says, watch this now, I have pardoned them as you requested, yet as surely as I live, and as the whole earth is filled with the Lord's glory, none of the men who have seen my glory and the signs I performed in Egypt and in the wilderness and have tested me these 10 times and did not obey me will ever see the land I swore to give their fathers. None of those who have despised me will see it. Hear me on this, beloved. In verse 2, they said, if only we had died in the land of Egypt, or if only we had died in this wilderness. Well, guess what happened? Some of them got their wish, because the Lord said they would not see the land. If you reject what the Lord has for you, God will withdraw what he had for you. My brothers and my sisters, understand it's never good to reject what the Lord has for you. Know that he always has the best for you, even when it comes to saving your soul. God has the best for you. And if you're listening this morning and you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I need you to understand when you refuse to accept his death on Calvary's cross for your sin, you are rejecting the salvation that the Lord has for you, and you are rejecting him. And there are consequences to rejecting the Son of God. And beloved, the consequence is if you die still in your rejection, there is a hell that awaits you. I don't care what nobody tells you. So don't listen to negative people when it comes to the Lord. Don't stay where you are or desire to go back. Don't follow anyone else, but go for Jesus and receive what he has for you. Go for Jesus and receive the blessings he has for you. Go for Jesus and get what the Lord has promised you. Because you see, in Jesus, God has promised us eternal life. In Jesus, God has promised us a home over in glory. In Jesus, God has promised he will never leave or forsake us. In Jesus, God has promised to be our God and we will be his people. In Jesus, God has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Don't reject what the Lord has for you. Tune out negative people. Don't stay where you are. Don't desire to go back to where God delivered you from. Don't follow no one else, but go and get what the Lord has for you. Whatever it is, God has promised it to to you, and it's yours. So go and get it. Don't reject what God has for you. Stop missing out on your blessings from God because you've been listening to other people. Because you are afraid to move forward in faith, so you will either want to remain where you are or go back to where God delivered you from. And don't stop following other people. Follow God. And he will lead you safely to what he has promised you. Follow him so that when you leave this earth, he will lead you safely home to glory. Don't reject what God has for you. Amen. 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 Let's give God some praise. Amen. Thank God for his Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, beloved, we want to take this time to offer Jesus Christ to someone who may be listening that does not have a relationship with him. You've been rejecting him. You didn't know it, but yes, you've been rejecting him all this time. Stop rejecting God. Stop rejecting his son, Jesus Christ. Stop rejecting the fact that Jesus died on the cross for your sin. Stop rejecting the fact that God raised him on the third day. Stop rejecting God's leadership by following someone else. But give your life to Jesus Christ. Receive him as your Lord and Savior. God has a land over in glory that he has promised to you. But the way to get it, you have to go through his son, Jesus Christ. And so we want you to do that today. Don't let this day pass you by. Then if there's someone who's listening, you're in the Milwaukee area, and you don't have a church home, but you know Jesus Christ, stop rejecting the fact that you need to be a part of a local congregation. Hebrews 10 and 25 makes it very clear. Quit rejecting it. Forsake not the fellowship. You need to be a part of a local body of believers. You need to be a part of the Lord's church. Amen. Amen. If you want to do that, either one of you, just click the hand that just came up. If you want to commit your life to Jesus, or you can let us know in the chat area about the decision you just made, or you can click the request prayer button, come into the host area where I am, and we can have a conversation about the decision you just made. If you decide to click the hand that just came up, that's going to take you to our website where you see the plan of salvation and ways to contact us through email or through phone call. Amen. Amen. For those of us who know Christ and are part of a church home, let us, as we get ready to pray, pray that the Lord would touch somebody's heart right now. Lead them to the saving grace of Jesus Christ or to become a part of our church family here at Greater Mount Zion. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, Lord, we thank you for your word, for Holy Spirit. Thank you, God, for what you've promised us. Pray right now for those who may be listening or viewing, don't have a relationship with you, God. They don't know Christ as their Savior. We pray now the Holy Spirit would move them to receive Jesus Christ. Pray right now for those who may be wondering. They know Christ, but they're wondering. They don't have a church home. God, we pray that Holy Spirit would move them to become a part of our church family here at Greater Mount Zion. It is in Christ's name that we pray and we thank you. Amen.
Amen. Well, thank you all so much for being a part of our worship service on this Sunday morning. Amen. Keep in mind that the sermon plays all during the week, Monday through Friday at 10 a.m. So if you have friends, relatives, family, get the word out to them. Give them the link, give them the website so that they can tune in if they have time, Mondays through Fridays at 10 a.m. to hear word from the Lord. I do also want to encourage you to show up for our prayer meeting on tomorrow at 6 p.m. Amen. We all need prayer, and we need to gather together as the people of God and pray. Many of you are getting the Zoom link for prayer meeting, Bible study, and Sunday school. And many of you, we don't see. Brothers and sisters, let's get serious about our relationship with the Lord and our fellowship with one another as brothers and sisters in Christ. And I do want to share something with you that I find surprising. When the church was open, we were all coming together. I noticed in our Sunday school, and I'm going to say this, many of us were coming together. Well, Sunday school is still going on, and we can still come together. Bible study is still going on. We can still come together. I just want to encourage us. Although we have a pandemic in the land, God has still made a way through technology for us to come together and study the Word of God, pray, and to worship Him. Amen. Amen. So let's start doing that as the Lord would have us. Amen. Well, let us close out with our benediction. Eternal God, our Father, we thank you so much for your word today. We thank you for being so good and so kind to us. We thank you, Lord, that you have something for us. All we have to do is go forward in faith to receive it and not reject what you have for us. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God and sweet communion of Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide with us now and forevermore. Let the people of God say, Amen. Amen. We love you, beloved. Have a good week.
to say this.